Thank you. That just kind of gets your blood moving in a Sunday morning. Good morning. Welcome to UD Spiritual Center of Lansing. Just as I say, welcome. We are all doing our things to be safe, whatever works for us. Some of us are at home joining us electronically. I love the ethers. But Charles Fillmore never thought when he turned the ethers that it was going to be literally we'd be traveling through the ethers. And of course, we have our tables here, our air exchange system, and masks when we're wandering around. So each of us in our own safe space for that. Coffee bar is open. Please help yourself. And our family area is open, too. We have a special place where people let the kids roam and play. And of course, our hearts and minds are open too. After all, it's Sunday morning, time to start the new week. I like to start right now with a prayer of wholeness for each of us, for our bodies, these wonderful vessels that we have to carry us through. So let's affirm together. In this moment, we bless the miraculous workings of our bodies. Conceived in divine mind, our bodies sparkle with health and vitality. We lay claim to our physical strength and resilience as we adopt practices to maintain and grow our health. Every day, we are guided to make choices and take actions that support the natural wholeness of our physical being, and so it is. Amen. And here at Unity, you know, this one slide with our mission statement, I have had a note up there on the side about this is the land that was the Three Fires Council, the Chippewa, the Ottawa, and the Potawatomi tribes. And I read something this week that some of the indigenous people, actually this can feel as an insult that says, this was your land and now it's ours. So I'm still trying to figure out more about the most political correct thing, but our intent is to honor our history and honor our future and honor the land of which we're on. So I just wanted to share that with you this morning. As we just review our mission statement of spiritually awakening to our oneness with God, each other, and all creation, and sometimes it takes us a while to figure out what the best way is to honor each other. And of course, out of our mission comes our vision of seeing a world that is powerfully transformed through a growing movement of a shared spiritual awakening. And in that shared spiritual awakening, we honor both our paths and other paths, wherever we are on that path. And one way of honoring that is to affirm an ecumenical prayer. So I invite you to join with me as we affirm together. The enlightenment of the Buddha shines within us. The compassion of the Christ moves through us. The power of Jehovah strengthens and guards us. The presence of Allah surrounds and guides us. Wherever we are, the Tao is, and all is God. And with that, to synchronize our hearts and minds as we get into a time of prayer, Greg's going to lead us, and you're welcome to sing in as we come into harmony, come into synchronization.
Our thoughts are prayers, and we are always praying. Our thoughts are prayers. Take charge of what you're saying. Seek a higher consciousness, a state of peacefulness, and know that God is always there. And every thought becomes a prayer.
And so we focus our thoughts in prayer by first holding our neighbors in prayers, our neighbors being any of those with whom we share this beautiful, magnificent planet with. We affirm, we pray with understanding and compassion in our hearts, knowing divine light shines even in the darkest moments. We bless the continued work of essential workers all around the world and all those devoting to serving others in times of need. We bless those in grief, whatever their loss, knowing God is their strength. We lift our gaze to remember our shared humanity, our unity of spirit. centered in God's divine presence within, we know the truth for each person in our world neighborhood. We are guided by wisdom arising in love as we act in ways that foster peace and wholeness for all. And so it is. And we continue in prayer with blessing for Unity Spiritual Center, which is you and I. So together, each of us as a Unity Spiritual Center community embrace our journey of spiritual growth. We are in the midst of our grand opening as a greater expression of love, a force for good in our neighborhood. We invest in emanating peace and harmony through unrelentless kindness to ourselves and others. Hand in hand, heart to heart, we delight in co-creating a beloved community. And so it is. Allah, Shalom, Amen, Namaste. Okay, we have set the arena. So, a little table question for you at your table. What are you saving for a special occasion? What are you saving for a special occasion? You got a couple minutes to share on that, and you'll hear some music, and you can come back with us as we sing together. And you at home, what are you saving? What are you saving for a special occasion? Maybe I put this up on Facebook and people could write it in.
That wouldn't be a bad idea.
Day before, I could put it on Facebook and yeah, they can go. There's a lot of saving going on, I can hear that. Okay, well, let's get some.
I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just where I'm supposed to be. At the right time, I am just what I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just what I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just what I'm supposed to be. I'm in the right place at the right time. I am just what I'm supposed to be. Oh, my soul is welcome here. Oh, my soul is welcome here. I am getting a message loud and clear. My soul is welcome here. 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 Oh, my soul is welcome here. My soul.
Good morning, I'm Kathy Asif, your platform assistant for today. Today's word is world peace. Inspired by the 2 Corinthians, put things in order, listen to my appeal, agree with one another, live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you. Peace in the world begins with each of us as individuals. We consider it our sacred responsibility to respond to all people and circumstances peacefully. We forgive ourselves for those moments we are less than peaceful and quickly return to the peace of God in our hearts. We are living expressions of God, just as other people are. Our tranquil bearing inspires peacefulness wherever we go and with everyone we meet. Each day, we join like-minded people everywhere in a renewed commitment to a presence of peace. We give thanks that, as each of us communicates God's love in our own unique ways, peace and harmonies are established in individuals, families, communities, and among nations throughout the world. Let us affirm together, I am a peaceful presence to all. This month, we focus on unity's core value of integrity. Integrity is our inner sense of wholeness, deriving from the qualities such as honesty and consistency of character. Integrity is the freedom of transparency, the unveiling of our authenticity when we do what we say and say what we do. Living in integrity is a reflection of our oneness with ourselves and with God. Integrity is not some special quality we save for important times, but a measure we live by every day. Our actions are kind, loving, and inclusive because we embrace our ability to be God expressing. Let's affirm our integrity statement together. We apply unity principles by making and keeping our agreement in thought, word, and action. This is the time of year we renew our annual membership. If you are currently a member, you should have received a renewal form in the mail. You can place your renewal forms in the box on the pedestal by the door. If you're not a member but are interested in becoming one, or if you'd just like to know more about Unity, on Sunday, November 7th, following the service, Reverend Sharon is offering Unity 101. Everyone is welcome. Our Sunday services are hybrid experiences, available to you both in person and live online, as well as recorded for later viewing, whichever works for you. Live stream and recordings are on our website and our YouTube channel. We are offering a variety of small group classes online, in person and hybrid. Information on these can be found on our new information stand located by the south windows. Details can also be found on our website, Facebook, and on our weekly e-news. Our prayer ministry continues to be active and available to hold you and your loved ones in prayer. Prayer requests can be placed in the prayer box, which has been relocated just behind the beige sofas, electronically through the website or with a phone call to the church. SALT is our Sunday adult learning time and meets at 9:30 each Sunday in the activity room off the sanctuary, over there. Next week at SALT, Curtis Pratt is leading a discussion on healing toxic beliefs. Next Sunday, Joshua Ignacio is returning to Unity. Following the Sunday service, he is offering a group vibrational healing experience. And after that, he's available for personal sessions of vibrational sound healings or readings. For more information on the workshop or to sign up for private sessions, check out the information tables. There has been so much happening around our church, so Sunday, October 31st, following the Sunday service, we are holding a town hall meeting to update everyone on our progress, to answer questions about future plans, and to listen to your ideas. That's the most important part, is listening to your ideas. Everyone is welcome. Following service, we invite you to join us for fellowship and refreshments. Also following the service is the monthly meeting of SAGE, our team who plans classes and events. Everyone is welcome to join the meeting. We hope you take some time to familiarize yourself with our information tables over there, again. Our new information rack has details on all of our activities. There is a small self-serve bookstore, information on teams over to the side next to our family area, and the prayer box behind the sofa. And now I'd like to welcome Elizabeth Kunc to share with us her special music.
This song, Have I Told You Lately? It's a love song for me to God this morning. Hope you enjoy it.
Have I told you lately that I love you? Have I told you there's no one else above you? Fill my heart with gladness, take away all my sadness. You ease my troubles, that's what you do. For the morning sun and all its glory greets the day with hope and comfort too. You fill my life with laughter, somehow you make it better. You ease my troubles, that's what you do. There's a love that's divine, and it's yours and it's mine, like the sun. And at the end of the day, we should give thanks and pray to the one, to the one. Have I told you lately that I love you? Have I told you there's just no one else above you? Fill my heart with gladness, you take away all my sadness, you ease my troubles, that's what you do.
Wow, that is just one of the most magnificent prayers I've ever heard. Doesn't that give you a different take on that song? Yeah. Nobody else above the love. That. Yeah. Wow. Oh, awesome. Okay. I know that people in Unity are very smart, so I have a quiz for you this morning. I don't want you to say any answers until you hear all the clues. because it's the same answer for all the questions I'm going to ask you. Okay, it's a seven-letter word. It preceded God. It is greater than God. All poor people have it. Wealthy people need it. And if you eat it, you will eventually die. Okay. Lee, did your hand go up? Do you have the answer? No. Think about it. What is greater than God? Ah, did you hear that? Nothing. So nothing preceded God. Nothing's greater than God. All poor people have nothing. Wealthy people need nothing. And if you eat nothing, you will eventually die. Right? Okay, so you get to go out and test all of your friends to see how sharp they are. Yeah. Okay, well, in the Bible, in the New Testament, there's these wonderful little conversations that happen, little side conversations that happen when Jesus is out in the countryside, much like we do after service, we gather, and then we have little conversations. And this ruler, they called him a ruler, he probably had a serfdom, a rich young man, he comes up to Jesus and he said, "What do I need to do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said, "You know, it's simple, just obey God's commandments, love one another, you know, be good, treat your neighbor well, just follow the commandments." And he goes, "Yeah, but what do I still lack? What else do I need to do?" And Jesus looked at him because he obviously wasn't getting it, so he put out kind of what I'm sure the man saw as a riddle. He said, "If you want to be perfect, sell your possessions, give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven." Oh, and he was destroyed. He said, "I'm very wealthy. I can't do that. I can't give everything away." And after he left, dejected, Jesus said, "It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven." And that's an expression we hear even in day-to-day language about the camel going through the eye of the needle. And there's explanations that the needle is what the entryway to the walled cities was called. It was quite small for, and of course, we like to think the whole idea of a camel actually trying to get through the head of a needle that I can't see anymore, to thread, even with a piece of thread, you know, let alone try to get a camel going through there. So as I was looking at this verse, because it's one of those interesting ones that kind of lingers in the back of your head, what the heck does this all mean? In the kingdom of heaven, when we talk about the kingdom of heaven, what are we talking about? You know, the golden streets, the pearly gates. What we're talking about is a realm of ideas that produce the effect of a harmony among all life, among all creation. The realm of ideas. It's not a place, except a place in consciousness. And it's within all of us. We all have this heavenly consciousness within us. It's in the place where you think about that we know and we understand God as principle, not a being out there that's going to reward or punish, but a set of operations within our universe that is so divine, so harmonically attuned to each other. There's this wonderful bit of perfection. So the other way of looking at it is that when we get to that place in consciousness, that place of heavenly thought, is when we're willing to surrender. We're willing to follow the will, the nudgings. Elizabeth and I were talking this morning about how every now and then you get an idea that you should do something, but that the logic mind kicks in and says no. And it was that little intuition, that little nudging to follow that, to surrender to it, and try to outthink instead of outthinking it, and to take that path, even though it might not seem logical to us, it might not seem like the perfect path, but it is, there's something telling us that this is where we need to be at this time for maybe reasons we don't even understand. So we talked about the kingdom of heaven. Remember, we're talking about consciousness here. Now we look at this metaphysically, this story. When Jesus was talking to the rich man, he wasn't talking about the welfare of the poor, give all your stuff to the poor. What he was talking about was the welfare of the rich man. That this man obviously had some attachment to his ownership of things. And the rich man in consciousness, remember when we read anything in the Bible, all the characters are within us. So that rich man is a part of our consciousness, that part of us that exists really impacts our personality that believes that we're judged by whatever's happening out here, or how we might appear out here, that that is how we are valued and that's how we are judged. So that's the rich man within us. And the personality, when he walks away, that's kind of the part of us that really gets disappointed that we can't have it all and take it with us. You know, none of us can even think of leaving this plane. And especially our personality gets very upset. Our ego thinks it needs to exist in this personality. So we're told we need to let go of attachment to really have the freedom, that spiritual freedom of beingness, even beyond the body. Our personality isn't happy with that. It's going to fight tooth and nail. You know, I'm here. I'm important. You got to see me in this ego entity. But there's a gift when we let go of all those things that we own and that we're free to the responsibility of it. Think about things we own. I think about our building. You know, there's a lot of things we need to do, give attention to. There's maintenance in our home, whether it's washing the floor or shoveling the driveway pretty soon. But we understand this different aspect of our life about not being attached to the things, to the outer appearances. There's a great freedom that comes with that. So metaphysically, the story of, you know, can a rich man enter the kingdom? It's like harder than getting a camel through the eye of a needle. It's the desire, and this is Charles Fillmore's words. He says, the desire and the will to surrender the limited personal outlook and follow the Christed consciousness, that divine consciousness within us, regardless of where the path may lead. That is the one thing the man is lacking. He is not willing to say, I let it go. You know, there's that saying, if somebody really loves you, you know, it's like a bird, if you let it go. If you're holding it tight, how do you know it's love? You open that, hold tightly with an open hand. And that same kind of adage holds true for so many things in our life. This is a picture of a covenant that was written by Charles and Myrtle Fillmore. They were co-founders of Unity. And this was written back in 1892. It wasn't found until 1942. But they had written this. And I want you to hear this covenant they wrote. It says, we, Charles Fillmore and Myrtle Fillmore, husband and wife, hereby dedicate ourselves, our time, our money, all we have and all we expect to have, to the spirit of truth and through it to the society of silent unity. It being understood and agreed that the said spirit of truth shall render unto us an equivalent for this dedication in peace of mind, health of body, wisdom, understanding, life, love, and an abundant supply of all things necessary to meet every want without our making any of these the object of our existence. This is the story of the rich man. This is Charles and Myrtle making that commitment to let go of attachment, dedicating it all to a higher purpose, knowing that in the harmony of the universe, their needs will be supported. And that's not why they're doing it. It's just part of the natural flow of things. In the presence of the conscious mind of Christ Jesus, the seventh day of December, 1892. And I always laugh with a new thought. Well, I don't know, anything that came from the 1800s seems like pretty old to me personally. And now we're 2 centuries away from that. So it's interesting that we have this, what's called a spiral of specialness. Our camels, if you will, those things that we cannot let go of to move forward. And we often talk about, especially in North America, we have kind of a consumption society. And then right now what's happening, the supply chain is upset. This flow of goods that was so easy to just consume, you know, and buy one thing after another. But even the while, so that thing has kind of slowed down a little bit, but also creates kind of a need. I better get it now while I have it. I know a few people that still have toilet paper left from a year ago, March, when that became the thing to have. You know, hair dye is another one people stocked up on. I'm not going to say who. So we have a consumption society and mindset, this kind of gathering, almost hoarding, if you will. There's another interesting thing that happens to us. We have this thing called non-consumption. And you think, non-consumption, well, why would that be a problem? Well, those unused possessions that are too special to use. And all of us have them. All of us have them. I pull this out today because this is one of my special tops I always save for a special occasion. Partly because it's white and it's easy to get dirty. I don't know how to clean it. But also, I knew that I was going to wear this on the day we consecrated the building, but I wasn't here, so it stayed in my closet. Well, boy, if I didn't wear it for that day, when is it going to be special enough for me to wear it again? And, you know, we do this with so many things in our life. We put it aside because it's just special. We bought it for something special. And the more we save it, the more special it becomes. So if you have it here for a specialness thing and you don't use it for that one, then it becomes even more special, so the event has to be even more special. And if you don't use it again, it becomes more and more special. And I mean, I know all of us have Christmas stuff that's only special enough to come out of Christmas. That's what makes it special, because we only bring it out at a special time. Yeah. So, interesting. So what happens is we get this clutter in our lives. Oh, boy, I don't even want you to see our basement of all those special things that we have down there that we're saving just for that special time when we're going to need it. Gets to the point that the possessions that we own begin owning us. There are people that buy storage containers to put those things that no longer fit in their house. I mean, talk about your possessions owning you when you have to find a rental space for these things that you own. And for most of us, it's not that big, but it's enough that it's kind of sludge in the flow of our energy that it just slows us down. It really attaches us to that camel. Instead of tying up the camel is tying us up. And you think about it, we all, you know, we want comfort in our living space. So why do we do things that we don't want to do? This is one of the questions Apostle Paul talked about. Why do I keep doing things I don't want to do? I mean, what is happening within me that I let these possessions own me? I know that I am having a spiritual experience in this human expression. So why would I take it even further down the vibrational level into things and let them own me? It's like, what are we waiting for? It could be a bottle of wine you buy for a special occasion. It doesn't get opened, so you save it and you save it. And pretty soon you got a wonderful bottle of vinegar, well, over time. Or candles. I have candles that are so dusty, I don't even know if they'll light anymore because they've been sitting there. And I have this little picture of the little snowman candles. And I know in our family, we had these special candles that were with the Christmas stuff, so it only got pulled out once a year. And you know, the poor little guys, the paint's chipping off, but you can't burn that little snowman. You can't burn that little wax Santa. It felt like blasphemy to do that. Oh, my goodness. And, you know, our ancestors would have rolled over in their graves on it. The one picture there is like a journaling book. And boy, have I been guilty of this. I buy this beautiful journal book. It's got the greatest cover. It feels good. I hold it, and I know all the things I'm going to write in it. And I can't, I'm waiting for something special for me to open it. Okay, I'm going to open it January 1st, 2022. And then something happened and I didn't. Okay, well, I'll wait to my birthday. That's the start of a new year. Or then I'll wait for the first day of summer. You know, that's kind of something mystical for me. You know, and there sits that book. I have three at home that are unopened because they're so beautiful. I'm waiting for that right and perfect situation, that special situation. And this becomes a specialness spiral. That the more we put something off, like we make up the story, right? We're totally making up these stories of specialness. I could feel the anxiety taking this out of the closet today. It's white. It's not one of those ultra special days. And then I thought, but it is. Today, it's today. You know, this is a special day. I woke up this morning. I'm feeling great this morning. It's a special day. So every time we forgo the use of something that we purchased and we tell ourselves, well, we're waiting, we have this belief that we are holding this, we're waiting for whatever, the possession feels more special. So, I mean, we create this story that literally snowballs, it just spirals out of control. We are such humorous people. We just entertain ourselves all the time with these stories. Oh, my goodness. There's a saying that thoughts become things, but as I was looking at this kind of weird humanness that we practice, things also become thoughts. Because as that specialness grows, our energy around it grows, and pretty soon we start allowing the outer to control our inner. The outer specialness factor out there starts shifting the way that we think. And if this thing, which is out there, has value, and we are doing things for the value of this thing, we have just given up our power. We know the divine is within us. This is the human consciousness, that Christed consciousness, the heaven within us. And instead, we're saying this is the good. This is the power, something out there, which has absolutely nothing but the story we gave it. So Ernest Holmes, Science of Mind, he said, the greatest good we can achieve should be affirmed as a part of our everyday existence. Our everyday existence. We venture forth into a life of action with a will to do, the determination to be, and the joy in becoming. I just love this idea of living it every day. There's not a specialness factor. There's not, I mean, think how this leaks into other areas of our life, you know. For somebody who has been on diet since they were 8, there was always that special day when I would start it, you know, tomorrow. Tomorrow never comes. As we're coming near Halloween, all the horror movies are coming out. And Jamie Lee Curtis, it's my dad's favorite fantasy date in the world. He loves Jamie Lee. And she was just featured in AARP magazine this month. Yeah, she's 62 now, still looks great, still vibrant. But she had been addicted to Vicodin because of an injury. In such a way that affected her personality. And so she has gone through this great metamorphosis of really getting back to the truth of who she is, going from the outer stuff, the expectations of other people, the specialness factor that really can really spiral out of control, especially when you get to that echelon of fame, if you will. And she shared this quote that really kind of gave her one of her wake-up calls to break her addiction, to get into treatment. And Doctorow is an author. I mean, these aren't necessarily special religious books, but he wrote, when ideas go unexamined and unchallenged for a long time, they become mythological and very, very powerful. They create conformity, they intimidate. I know I was told, not only did I pull out this special white covering, I pulled it out on October 17th. Now my myth was, after Labor Day, you do not wear white. If you're a bride, it better be winter white, right? So that myth that you don't wear, you don't do this, you don't do that by such and such a date, I mean, we all have them. Our families have had them and not, you know, looked at them in question because it was, the myth became so strong. This is what we had to do. How many of you have changed the menu for Thanksgiving from what your parents or Lee, you probably did. Yeah. Well, you had a whole metamorphosis of change in there. Yeah. But there, you know the routine and consciousness of breaking that idea that you had before, that this is what a Thanksgiving dinner has to look like. And then she was reading East of Eden by John Steinbeck, and he said, the free exploring mind of the individual human is the most valuable thing in the world. And can you feel how those possessions that start owning us all of a sudden start limiting our mind? Our mind no longer is free because we're caught up in the story, the myth, these very powerful ideas. There's a great movie out a couple years ago, Inside Out. It's a kid's movie, but oh my goodness, it was just so good. Because the outside, it's really from the inside out, but we allow ourselves to make the outside start impacting the inside. So if you think about what are you saving for a special event, why are you holding back something for tomorrow, and where does that belief come from? Where does that belief come from? One of my aunts, when she died, and he cleaned out the dresser, and in the dresser was all the birthday and Christmas cards she'd ever gotten, including the money that was put in there. I don't know what she was saving it for. I heard, he's talking about tablecloths, how you save the tablecloths for the good event, right? We all have those stories. And so, boy, this journey to self-knowledge about, you know, what are we telling ourselves is just an amazing and something humorous one. Because all those things boil down to really is a belief in lack. when we don't use it right now, because we think we'll never get it again. Because we think that this is so unique and so different that it's the only one in the world. In a few cases, that might be true. But for the most part, the things we're being attached to can be replaced. You know, nothing is lost in the universe. That idea of lack is our camel. As soon as we think that this is a limited universe, that if I use it up now, I won't have it then, in the future, where I might need it. If I use it up now, I will never get it again. If I burn that candle, I will never find another Santa Claus candle that I can hand down for generations to never be burnt. Excuse me. So, give your camel its freedom, right? Just let it go. And I don't know who wrote this, but it's really about kind of cleansing the vision, the story that we're making up. It's not events, but the outcomes. Visualize the outcomes. So if you're not using that bottle of wine because you want to have, it's not the special time yet. Visualize using it and then getting an even more expensive bottle of wine, or get a more glorious candle, whatever that might be. It's not cracking the bat, but sliding over home plate. Seeing yourself in that finished thing with everything that you need. Not the inking of the deals, but the success that comes from that. Not the healthy food or the bathroom scales, but our body's fitness. Not when, where, and how, but the satisfaction, laughter, and contentment. Not events and outcomes. Visualize the outcomes. When we are tied to that specialness spiral, we are visualizing limitations. We are visualizing that this will never be an opportunity again to do whatever it is we've made the story about. And I think this is important because it's about our relationship with God. You know, as Elizabeth was singing that beautiful prayer song, "Have I Told You Lately That I Love You?" If we are doing this with things, chances are we're doing this with God. God is very special, and I'm going to save that relationship for when I really need it. When it's really important, when things are really disastrous, then I'll go to God. But right now, the day-to-day life, I'm going to stumble around and just kind of, you know, work with this myself. Because it's like, you know, if you think about it, how many times have you just thought it was too special to activate this relationship, too special to go with God, that somehow there's only so much good we get in our life, we don't want to use it up? I mean, that may be true of a chocolate candy bar. It's not true about spirit. Spirit is infinite in every place. And do we have still in our mind some concept of God that is capricious, that's ever-changing, that, okay, there's good today, but maybe tomorrow this capriciousness of spirit is going to start punishing me, start making demands on me that I can't fulfill? It's like, when do we revert to prayer? Do we do it at the beginning of the event, or do we do it as a last resort, right? And, you know, we've all been guilty of that last resort attack to prayer. It's not time for prayer yet. If we're time to prayer, it's really disastrous. So, very simply, really, about being here now, not forced by our things, but to be here now in consciousness. And what does the future I want to create require of me today? What does the future I want to create require of me today? It might be to figure out who your camel is, what it is, and to let it go. What is that something that is so special you're saving it? Or are you ready today to really enter into that kingdom of creative consciousness, that kingdom of wholeness, that kingdom of the Christed Spirit, to step in a new direction and take a deep breath and surrender to those divine urges, whatever they may be, not even knowing where it's going to take you, perhaps. And you know what? You're allowed and even encouraged to be happy in the process. We're going to take a little time in that process as we join together in meditation. Oh, Greg is going to lead us in a song to take us there. But right now, just take a moment and make sure you're comfortable. Take a deep breath and open your ears. You're welcome to sing along. Greg, I'll turn it over to you.
I'm raising the veil between me and my God. No separation, no distance at all. God is right here in my heart. is right here in my heart. God is right here in my heart. I'm raising the veil. I want to know. I want to see you, oh God, I'm raising the veil. I want to hear you, oh God, I'm raising the veil. I want to feel you, oh God, I'm raising the veil. I want to
invite you to close your eyes if that's comfortable, to allow yourself to drift into that deeper sense of being, just as that music takes us deeper inside. Enjoying the breath of this moment with no need to hold it and save it, completely confident that as we release, our next need for a breath will be met. In this moment, in every moment, we have that ability to choose. To choose to let go of those things that separate us from our greatest good. In our mind, we might visualize those things that we are attached to, that we save, in the mistaken belief that to truly savor it, it needs to be postponed for something special. And what is more special than this moment? We have stories and mythologies of our own making, some inherited, some ever-changing. Good stories that limit the enjoyment of what we have been presented in this moment. We have a standing invitation to live in the kingdom of heaven, a place where we are released from any limited stories, a place where we can function through divine nudges, through that still small voice, and through a quickened wisdom in our own intellect that leads us forward to be a joy to ourselves, to our friends and family, to raise the bar of joy for our world. So as we consider what may be holding us back, as we consider what veil has fallen between us and the divine, let us open our heart to feel what it would be like to fully release and let go, to savor this moment, to utilize those things that are in our realm of existence, and to do so with joy, peace, exuberance. Let's take a moment right now to feel what it is like to loose our Campbells. As the veil comes down, we remember to say, I love you. As we affirm in our hearts infinite presence, I welcome the call to live fully, express authentically, and to simply be happy. This ideal is made real by my prayers for divine connection, and by devoting my talents, energy, and spiritual essence to the day, this day, embracing those in my orbit with light and joy. Thank you, God, forever. Amen. Thank you, Greg. So a spiritual practice for this week. This is a quote that really grabbed me as I came across it. It says, life hinges on a couple of seconds you never see coming. What you decide in those few seconds determines everything from then on. And you have no idea what you'll do until you're there. Let your camel go so that you're ready for the big stuff. Identify your camels and let them loose. With that, I'd like to invite Elizabeth up to encourage, to extend my encouragement of being loose. Well, in the very best sense of loose,
I hope you dance. Whenever one door closes, I hope one more opens. Give the heavens above more than just a passing glance. When you get the choice to sit it out or dance.
All I can say is wow. Wow. Now I'm gonna. So this is a time during our Sunday service when we engage in the sacred practice of generosity. As individuals, we take a moment to feel deep appreciation for the love, the kindness, and the support that blessed each of our individual lives. As a community, we enthusiastically express gratitude to everyone who has continued to support Unity through this most unusual time. It is because of our financial gifts and love offerings and the tremendous work of our teams of volunteers that this ministry continues to thrive. Our circle of generosity includes an act of gratitude for these many gifts as we share of our gifts with others. As a community, for the fourth quarter of this year, we have chosen to share our gifts with three incredible organizations. Care for the Caregivers, supporting nurses at Sparrow Hospital, Potter Park Zoo, supporting the animals, and Youth Haven, supporting our young people. Let us take a moment to immerse ourselves in deepest gratitude by singing, I Am So Blessed.
I am so blessed, I am so blessed, I am so grateful for all that I have. I am so blessed, I am so blessed, I am so grateful.
Generosity is a sacred exchange of giving and receiving. Because we are blessed, it is with joy and enthusiasm that we as individuals share of our many blessings to complete the circle. Some of us prefer to share with Unity through gifts made online or through the mail. Others of us prefer to make our sacred exchange at a service. You can use the envelopes in the sunflower basket. And when you are complete with a blessing, place it in the glass container on the table. These envelopes will be safely collected by our ushers following the close of service. Let us celebrate the circle of prosperity by affirming together. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. I praise, give thanks, and am glad. Now let us stand as we sing our closing song, I Choose Peace, followed by the prayer for protection.
God is, and all is well.